This podcast is part two of a faculty development workshop considering issues of personal and shared information management. My name is Candace Gibson, and I'm an associate professor in the Department of Pathology and Laboratory Medicine and assistant dean at the Schulich School of Medicine and Dentistry here at Western University. I would like to gratefully acknowledge the support of the Association of Faculties of Medicine of Canada and Canada Health InfoWay in producing this workshop series and these podcasts. I have no conflict of interest to declare with regard to the content of this presentation. In the previous module in Part 1, we looked at personal information management and started to explore some aspects of shared information. Granting access to others to your files or a shared workspace. But in healthcare, this goes beyond simple file sharing to the sharing of information within an electronic record, for instance, within a single department or office, to sharing that information across the entire healthcare enterprise, across facilities, from hospital to physician's office, and even from physician to patient. To be able to do that efficiently, some technical and procedural aspects need to be in place and the purpose of our collaboration defined. Increasingly, we are working together in groups and teams, and we need to share information and knowledge. In the construction of new knowledge, we also are dependent on the expertise and knowledge of many. In practice, we can learn from colleagues and share those best practices through communities of practice using software applications such as wikis, Google Docs, Dropbox, or fully featured SharePoint sites. We can also share through linked records, information with other physicians, members of an interprofessional healthcare team, and even with patients. We see an increasing number of patient portals providing access to test results, scheduling, prescription renewals, and the bidirectional reporting of parameters in some cases. Technically, we require some interface standards and ideally a single port of entry to access multiple applications. We need systems that can talk to one another. Interoperability. For that to happen, we need to have some standards in place that relate to data vocabulary, data transfer and exchange, document structure, technology, architecture, and privacy standards. Privacy, confidentiality, and security in Canada is ensured by the adherence to the 10 fair information practices that form the basis for federal and provincial laws. Looking at another of the e-health competencies, we can see information sharing is emphasized in the role of collaborator. With the need to know and apply the Canadian standards for recording, communicating, sharing, and classifying health information. Over the next few slides, we'll look at a few of the key pan-Canadian standards for data coding and classification. But first, let's start with some simple definitions. We have encountered some of these in Part 1 in using a thesaurus or in searching a medical literature database such as PubMed using the National Library of Medicine's controlled vocabulary or MeSH terms, the medical subject headings, or index terms. These terms are constantly reviewed and updated and new terms added as new diseases such as AIDS or SARS, or areas of study come into being. For instance, medical informatics was first introduced as a MeSH term in 1987, and informatics, which subsumes health informatics and e-health, introduced in 2005. Classification schemes in general present an ordered system of concepts or categories within a specific domain. The purpose is to classify data in a logical manner that coincides with the requirements for its intended use, for example, to describe a diagnosis or disease, or a procedure or intervention. Within the health record, several Canadian and international standards are used. For instance, all hospital visits are coded and abstracted using the International Classification of Disease, version 10. ICD-10-CA is the current Canadian standard and contains over 60,000 individual codes to classify disease, injuries, and causes of death. The accompanying Canadian Classification of Interventions, or CCI, provides the coding background for medical surgical procedures as well as psychological counseling and other types of interventions. Within primary care, both the ICD-9 codes or the International Classification of Primary Care are used. All of that information is transmitted to the Canadian Institute for Health Information and summary reports sent back to the facilities to guide planning and management of resources, funding, or deployment of necessary services. Not all cases fit the ICD-9 or ICD-10 standards, and a different form of coding system has been introduced and approved for use in electronic records in Canada known as SNOMED or SNOMED CT. In this system, no predefined codes are set, and the user is able to define the code based on a number of axes that can include anatomy, morphology, or etiology, for instance. Thus, in this case, literally thousands of possible combinations exist. This type of nomenclature or naming system has greater utility for research purposes and can be much more granular in the information that it provides. While both codes exist, we need to have that thesaurus, or the map, of one system to another. Many additional data standards exist, for instance, LOINC for laboratory and clinical test results, data transmission standards that are accepted internationally, the Health Level 7 standard that is based on XML, the extensible markup language, and you may know that best through a subset of XML, HTML, that's the standard specification for web pages for display of content. Documentation standards exist that define, for instance, a continuity of care document that would contain pertinent patient information, admission, diagnosis, discharge instructions, medications, or coded entries in SNOMED or LOINC. It can also include other documents, including scanned images, PDFs, or Word docs. Documentation standards also exist as templates for family history, social history, medications, immunizations, problems, procedures, etc. The key to good coding and abstraction in all of these cases is the original clinical documentation and the need for complete and precise initial documentation. This allows better capture of data initially that can be used optimally many times. An additional note here about patients and consumers who are demanding that information be shared between doctor and patient. Information sharing is also going beyond simply the clinician or provider. Patients are sharing information with one another. They are increasingly measuring health status with wearable devices that can be uploaded to a health record, be that a personal health record or an electronic medical record or health record. One group, patients like me, was recently awarded a $900,000 grant from the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation to help jumpstart changes that will include the patient voice in the measurement of healthcare performance. A portion of that grant funds a collaboration between patients like me and the National Quality Forum to develop, test, and facilitate the broader use of patient-reported outcome measures to assess patient-reported health status. Ultimately, in sharing information, we generate new knowledge for the treatment of others. Along the data, to information to knowledge continuum, we collect information on individual patients that can then be, especially in a digital world, more easily collected and added to a knowledge database that enables improved treatment within a practice. Current knowledge bases that we use are those medical literature repositories that have been built up over time with research and best medical evidence. In this figure, we can see how this information cycle operates in the care and treatment of an individual patient. Ultimately, we can see a learning health system in which collated and interpreted information is automatically fed back to the individual clinician at the point of care. With the advent of electronic records, digital tools such as data repositories, clinical decision support systems, and information can be shared and compared within a practice across several practices, a region, or a province. Data and knowledge repositories based on hundreds of patients can be analyzed and information used for decision support and provision of up-to-date and tailored diagnosis and treatment for the individual patient at the point of care. These podcasts form a very brief introduction to ideas of personal and shared information management. And within the other series of workshops and video and audio casts in the areas of clinical information management, health communications, and clinical decision support systems can be used as resources for your learning. Additional resources, articles, and papers are available in the eHealth Resources Toolkit, and we will continue to add to those. I urge you to look for opportunities within your own faculty and your own discipline to incorporate eHealth and informatics examples into your teaching. Links are also provided here to examples from two medical schools who have embarked on a full integration of health informatics into the curriculum. In one case, Florida State University, and in Canada, an example provided by Dr. Kendall Ho at the University of British Columbia.